We've got Pooja Subramanian from ThoughtWorks. I hope I pronounced that right. And Archana Ravikumar from BCG Digital Ventures. So Pooja, who's just joined us, hello Pooja, is currently the technology principal for ThoughtWorks Southeast Asia Market Portfolio and the office tech principal for ThoughtWorks Bangalore. In her role as tech principal and lead consultant, she works closely with senior client stakeholders to ensure that a consistent delivery of quality software has the desired impact on the business. She's also responsible for the technical quality of all projects delivered from our Bangalore offices. And I believe we're also going to be joined by Archana, who is the tech lead with experience in retail, microfinance, travel, health, insurance, India Stack, and IoT domains. She has a keen interest in facilitating product design, architecting applications, leading teams to deliver solutions, and coaching individuals and teams. And there she's coming now, Archana. Archana has also worked across different technologies like .NET, Java, ROR, Golang, and Clojure. She's an avid reader, a board game geek, and a coffee addict. And Pooja and Archana are going to tell us how to build a scalable API platform for an IoT ecosystem. So off to you.
Thank you. Archana, do you want to share the screen?
Yes, just a second. I'm getting it ready to share. Okay. Are you able to see the screen, Pooja?
Yeah, I can. Cool, so let's get started. Thanks, Dan. Hello, everyone. Archana and I recently worked on building a smart connected buildings platform for a large enterprise. Today, we'd like to share some of our learnings from that. We'll first start by talking about what an IoT stack looks like and where our IoT platform fits into this whole thing. Right. So one can think about the IoT ecosystem, the different components in the IoT ecosystem as different layers. The lowest couple of layers would consist of sensors and actuators, which actually translate between the physical quantities of the environment, like your temperature, humidity, etc., and your digital data for your cloud to consume. The next level consists of a set of adapters and on-premise gateways that would serve as a bridge between the sensors and the actuators and the cloud. And the following that, you would have services on the cloud that consume data provided by the sensors. And there's also the other way communication possible, where you could provide commands to the different actuators on the premise, right? And finally, you would have consumer applications, which would allow you to control these devices by consuming APIs that are present on the cloud services. Now, for this talk, we'll concentrate mostly on the cloud layer. We'll talk a bit about the different practices that we had in our experience while working on building this API platform. For the purpose of illustration, I'll just quickly talk about one of the use cases that we worked on, which was for a hotel chain management. They wanted to optimize the energy savings in their hotels. So in the sense that they wanted to put in automated mechanisms for like regulating air temperature within rooms, figure out if there is a room occupancy, if there are people within a room, then you maintain optimum temperature in the room. If there are people who are absent in the room, then you sort of control the temperature so that your energy is safe. Now the hotel would have multiple rooms and each of the rooms has multiple sensors which measure each of these quantities like temperature, occupancy of the room, dew, what is the humidity of the room and things like that. Each of these sensors would then connect to a control unit that aggregates the different data coming from the different sensors in the room. So your sensors themselves are very low capacity, low bandwidth devices, and you'll need a slightly more powerful device like the control unit to process some of these data and make localized decisions based on devices data from two or more different sensors. In turn, each of these control units would then be connected to a gateway that is responsible for communication between the devices and the cloud. The cloud services can now act on the data that are received from the sensors, and they can also provide commands to the actuators based on this. As your application evolves and gets more complex, it's advisable to have all of your business logic and data processing on the cloud side of things, so that it allows you to have more control on what you can do with the data that you get. And these, the data and controls can be exposed as APIs by these cloud services, which can then be consumed by some of your end channel applications. Like perhaps you could have like a web app that could assist these hotel management staff to figure out if there's any anomaly within each of the rooms. It can allow your guests to monitor the status of their room, control the various parameters of their rooms from wherever they are, and any such sort of mobile applications, right? To ensure that this happens, the IoT platform needs to have some considerations in place. And that's what makes this IoT application slightly different from any regular CRUD application. So from our experience, these are some of the key aspects that need to be considered while building your IoT platform. The first one is context mapping. We'll talk a bit about each of these in subsequent slides. And then you have device representation, which talks about how do you model your device within the cloud. Then there's scale. How do you handle scale? Because there's going to be multiple different devices that are connecting to your platform. Security, of course, this is important in any regular platform as well. But given the IoT ecosystem, given a lot of devices connecting, and given that each of these devices could be remote, security becomes all the more important here. And of course, the last one is the continuous improvement. How do you ensure that you send out updates to your remote devices? How do you ensure CI/CD in an IoT kind of an ecosystem? So that's the last parameter that we'll talk about. So the first thing that we'll now talk about is context mapping. What's context mapping, right? In the use case that I just described, there are many, many sensors that are transmitting data from different rooms. There are sensors at room level, there could be sensors at floor levels. So when I receive data on the cloud, I should be able to tell which part of the building did this particular data come from, right? And I need to be able to associate the data to the corresponding source. For this, you'll have to translate the building context itself into our services. Like your services would have to know how many floors are present, which rooms are present on which floor, and where exactly is this device located. And using this information, and knowing the attributes of the devices itself that are transmitting the data, that's how you can easily derive a relationship between the two and make sense of the data coming in. For example, you could easily address use cases like, hey, room 101 is unoccupied, but I can see that there's a light turned on. Let me just send a command to turn it off, right? So these kind of use cases you can easily handle if you're able to model your building itself into your cloud platform. Now, how do you actually model the physical device itself onto your IoT platform? That's where device representation concept comes into play. And there are multiple ways in which you could do this. Archana will just quickly walk us through what each of these methods are.
Sure. Thank you, Pooja. So to talk about device representation models, there are many different ways in which we can represent a physical device on the cloud to make it more efficient for a connected IoT-based use case. So even with the example that Pooja just gave about context mapping, where we take data from several different devices in several different physical locations and try to make sense of how they work together, there could be one or two models which work better for that use case compared to the others. So in the project that I worked on, where we tried to build a home security system using sensors and other connected devices, we actually had the flexibility to try a couple of different models to see what worked for us. And so what I'm going to talk about now is my learnings, is just like an introduction to each one of these representation models and learnings from how we implemented them, what's a good way to implement these models and what's not. So the first one that I'll be talking about is called the actor model. The actor model, some of you might be familiar with this. It's loosely based on the actor model in Akka. We call this as the reliable actor model. So in this actor model, the key things to notice are that the devices, the physical devices that are out there in the field, are all modeled as actors. And when I say actors, what that means is these devices are, each one is kind of like a long-running process and it has the capability to receive messages, execute the message, process something related to that message, and then go to sleep until it gets the next incoming request. So on this, in this kind of concurrent process model, the devices can actually form a hierarchy, connect with each other based on a hierarchy, and communicate with each other by sending messages to message queues with each other. So each device is represented as an actor, and the actor can do processing. The actor also has a message queue that it can use to receive incoming messages. And then the way we implemented it was we used this in conjunction with Cosmos DB on Azure. So I'll show you a representation of each actor, the JSON example of representation of each actor in the next slide. But what we would do is the actor would come to life. It would listen to requests. So when there is an incoming request, it would come to life. It would execute that request. And then when there is no more request for a period of time, it would go to sleep. But when it goes to sleep, it will persist its current state in the Cosmos DB so that the next time it has to service another request, it can quickly retrieve it from the database and process it quickly. So if we go into the hierarchy itself that the actors can have, in the use case that Pooja explained, we were talking about a hotel with multiple floors, multiple rooms, and devices, multiple devices in each room. So the actor model can actually help us model this hierarchy and talk about which device is connected to which room and which room is connected to which floor and so on and so forth. So you could take this quite far and say that every component in the system can be modeled as an actor. So you could have an actor for the hotel, you could have an actor for the floor and so on and so forth. We actually tried to implement this. We had an actor for each user and we had an actor for each device that the user had, and there was a hierarchy between the user and the device. But in my experience, this was a little bit tricky because if you think about the sort of consolidated IoT structure that Pooja shared a couple of slides ago, we are actually talking about three different layers. So there's the front-end layer, there's the mobile web front-end layer, then there's the cloud layer, and then there's the device layer. And making everything an actor means that you kind of have to use the same contract to represent a device in all three layers. And then if you extend it to other components other than the device, then you have to use the same JSON representation, same JSON contract across the mobile application, the cloud, and device if it applies, right? When you do that, as the application becomes more complex, it becomes very tricky to make changes through all layers at the same time and sort of go fast and deliver your new features to the market very fast. So we tried this out. It definitely had some use cases. So maybe using it in a restrictive setting just for devices is a good use case. But since this did not work out so well for us, we tried another representation called the device twin. So the device twin is just the name of the model representation in Azure Cloud. But this is very similar to shadow devices on AWS, if you're familiar with that. So the device twin is nothing but way to represent your device in a very concise way. So I would call this as the virtual representation of your physical device out in the field. And if you look at what it has, it's got some components here. So we'll go through these one by one. Sorry about that. We'll go through the components here one by one. So the device twin has something called as tags, and these tags are just metadata that is not actually visible to the user or anybody, but it is metadata that you can, for example, use to track where is this device present, what is the physical location of this device. So if you look at the example here, this is nothing but the JSON representation of the device. And if you look at the example here, the tag says, what is the deployment location of this device? So it is in building 43 and on the first floor. The next set of details that we have here are called properties. And within properties, you can have any number of properties. And each property would be represented in two states. So there's something called as a desired property and another thing called as the reported property. So the way it would work is this device. So let's assume that this is out in the field. This is a physical device. So let's take the example of a thermostat. So the thermostat reads the current temperature, and so the reported temperature would be the current temperature. So let's say it's 23 degrees Celsius. So the device would record this as the reported temperature. And so now let's say that somebody wants to reduce the temperature to 21 degrees. So we would have an incoming request come from any of the front-end applications, like a mobile device or a web application. That would come to the cloud. So on the cloud, where this device twin is, we would change the desired property to 21 degrees Celsius. And when we do this, this would then be sent as a request to the device to say desired property is now 21 degrees Celsius and reported would be 23. So as soon as the device receives this command, it knows that there is a difference between the desired and the reported properties. It has to change its reported property to the desired state. So it will change the temperature and send back an acknowledgement. And when it sends back the acknowledgement, both the desired and reported property would become 21 degrees Celsius. So this is like a very simplistic example of how a communication would work using a device twin. But as your device becomes more complex and is capable of doing other complicated things, you can have more representation of properties on your device. The flip side of this is, let's say that your temperature in your thermostat changes, and it could change not just because of a command from an end user, it could change for any number of use cases. Like it could, there could be an environmental reason why it changed, or somebody manually changed it on the device. So when that happens, let's say the temperature goes down to 18 degrees Celsius. Now, this is a command that was activated outside the scope of this ecosystem, but the device will still record it. It will change the reported temperature to 18 degrees Celsius, and then it will send this message back to the cloud. So when a user, like I'm a user and I just want to check what the current temperature is, when I'm checking it on my app, the request to find the current state of the device wouldn't go as far as the physical device. We'll just get the value of the change state from the device twin here and send it back. So it kind of acts like a cache. So every time there is a change in the device state, it doesn't have to be sent back to the user. And every time user wants to know the updated state of a device, it doesn't have to go all the way to the physical device. Moving on, another representation of a device is a model called the OCF model. So the OCF, so this is something we didn't actually get time to implement, but this is something we did a lot of research on because it seemed like a really good and open specification that we could adapt to allow our devices to be used in a really open ecosystem. So Open Connectivity Foundation, or OCF, is a consortium of many companies that have come together to create a sort of program that maintains and provides specifications, code. They even have an editor and certification program that helps manufacturers build their devices to a specification that allows application developers to use a common set of specification and standards so that these devices can be used in a more open way. So for example, from an end user perspective, if you have a security device or a home control device from Nest, and you have like a Philips light bulb or a temperature sensor, and you want to connect these two together, it might not be very easy or straightforward because they come from two different manufacturers. But that is the bridge, that is a gap that OCF is trying to bridge by providing common specifications that everybody can adapt and bring together like a more open ecosystem. So quickly, I'll just talk about the definition of a thing as provided by OCF. So it's very similar to the device twin concept. So what we have here is a device has two sets of properties or things. So one is the resources or properties, which is its current state. So which could be whether it's on or off, what is the dimming setting, what is the brightness of the bulb, etc. And then there are functions, which are operations that let you control these properties. So it's very similar to the example that I showed before. So in order to change this light bulb, you'd call the operations, which would then act on specific properties. Now, if we step into this a little bit more and talk about what is the representation of a device, of a thing, and what is the specification about. So this is the latest specification recommendation from OCF. And as you can see, it's split into several layers. So if you look at the bottom layer, it's got connectivity, networking, transport. So the idea here is that irrespective of what the device is capable of or which domain it belongs to, there are some core capabilities that will remain standard and will always be built the same way. So that's the lower part. So how you connect, what protocols you use to connect, all of these will stay pretty standard. The layer above talks about the framework. So this is a level of intelligence that you're adding on. So how do you manage devices? How is device discovery done? How do you manage CRUD operations and notifications? All of these are one layer above, but they're also pretty standard. So any device that you have that implements the OCF framework, irrespective of what capability it specifically has, will always have the two bottom layers, which are generic. And then if you go one layer up, you can then talk about specific capabilities that relate to the domain that the device belongs to. So it could be smart home, automobiles, e-health, industrial, whatever that is. And then on top of that, you can layer it with OCF models and any application logic. And security is a cross-cutting concern that runs across all layers. So this is like a really high level representation of what a thing is and how it can be represented. And if you get into details, what happens is between devices, the communication happens at the respective level. So network to network, framework to framework, so on and so forth. And that's how you can maintain like a uniform standard of communications that can open up your ecosystem to be used by many different types of devices. That's sort of the end of the representation, different types of representation of a device we could have. But once we have this in place, this is like really low level implementation detail of how you would represent a device. The next thing we want to talk about is once you have done this and you've represented the device, the thing sort of like escalates out of control. So you're suddenly going to have millions of devices or at least hundreds of thousands of devices out in the physical environment. And so what does this mean? And how do you build things in a way that it adapts to such a scale? So that's going to be the next part. I'll hand back over to Pooja to talk about scale.
Yeah. So like Archana was saying, there's going to be a lot more devices that are connecting to your IoT platform. There's a Gartner report that says that there'll be about 25 billion connected things by 2025. And that's just a huge volume of data, right? So the massive amount of incoming data based on the frequency at which these devices transmit data is going to be an important factor to consider when you build your IoT platform. To give an example, right, in our use case, we had devices that used to ping us every 5 minutes to inform us of their keep alive status. So they used to keep pinging us to say, hey, I'm alive. And this sort of health check was important for us in our use case. So our IoT platforms should be built to handle scale, to handle this kind of a volume. Now, depending on the criticality of your application, this data might have to be processed immediately for some use cases, or you could probably delay this processing to some extent for other use cases. For example, if you have like a security or a health related application where your incoming signal from the device needs to be informed immediately, and an alarm has to be raised immediately, then you would need a more real-time processing of your data when compared to other applications like, for example, a dashboard of your energy consumption, which could factor in some amount of delay for the data coming from the devices. So the way we handle scale in our application, we had four measures that we took, and these are some of them. The first one is to have a gateway. Now, this gateway will act as the first point of contact between the devices and the cloud. And our solution was deployed on Azure, and we used Azure IoT Hub for this purpose. Now, the gateway basically allows for a bidirectional communication between the cloud and the devices. When I say bidirectional, sensors sending data into the cloud and the services being able to send command back to your devices to perform whatever operations they have to. Now, this would also perform some amount of data aggregation, given that each of the devices could use different protocols. So how do I maintain sync and enable the bidirectional communication? That's what the gateway was used for. We also had a telemetry service. So like we said, we had the keep alive pings every now and then. And the sheer volume of data was so huge that we couldn't directly process each of the pings that were coming to us. So we had a gateway sort of a thing in front of it, which was the telemetry service. And this was basically responsible for tracking the status of the devices. And if we had to scale our application, this was the first point that we would go and investigate to be able to scale out and span out to more devices. We also had a time series database to partition data into chunks for handling the loads. This was used to basically capture the change in state of devices over a period of time. So it would facilitate easy data writes and access. And since time was treated as a first class citizen here, we were allowed to respond quickly to time critical applications. Now, this time series database was also helpful for us in generating dashboards, figuring out are there any anomalies within each of the rooms and things like that. So this was extremely useful for us to handle those kind of use cases as well. And of course, we also had a cache for easy access and quick access, where some of the pre-processing that we had to do could be pushed into the cache. All we had to take care of was to be able to configure the cache updates. And we also had to consider what needs to go into the cache and what can be sitting outside of the cache as well. The last aspect that we'll talk about now is the security. I think in the previous talk with Michelle, there was a question around what are some of the best practices on security, right? So I hope this might provide an answer to that. So a lot of consumers find it hard to trust these IoT applications given the sensitivity of the data that gets collected. Just having one vulnerable device can give an attacker access to the entire ecosystem itself. So consider the temperature sensor that I mentioned earlier. The rooms in the hotel had to control and monitor the temperature changes, right, using these sensors. Now, in order for the temperature sensor to gain access to the internet, it requires to be connected to a local network. And if you're connecting to a Wi-Fi, then that's an entry point for attackers to come and attack your system, right? So all it takes is for an engineer to decide or to forget to implement some security protocol on it, and something as simple as a temperature sensor could be your gateway into an attack. To mitigate this risk, we had put in place a few measures. Like, for example, we had access control on each of the APIs as well as the functionalities to ensure that, for example, a guest in one room should not be able to access the parameters of another room, right? So you need to be clear about the access control there. We had to take care of data confidentiality, not just during storage, but also during the transfer of data between the edge devices and the cloud. So we had things like encrypted storage and other measures which would take care of storage. And of course, there were we had to take care of firmware updates because the devices are going to be remote. How do you patch security updates as and when vulnerabilities get discovered? That's the last aspect. I think Archana will just quickly cover that.
Definitely. Thanks, Pooja. So just in the interest of time, I won't go through all the details here, but we were trying to figure out how to do continuous deployment to our devices. So definitely one takeaway that I'll share here is to make sure that you implement for OTA right from the beginning, because there's no other way you'll be able to simultaneously update all your devices in the field at the same time, even when there are like vulnerabilities and issues like that. I'm just going to show you this sample architecture that we had and leave it there and perhaps stop for questions. I'm very conscious that we are about to finish on time.
Yes, we only have 2 minutes left, and we do have a couple of questions. So the first one is there any rate limit applied to IoT when sending data to the cloud?
That's a really good question. So for our use case, we didn't have to implement any rate limit because we just leveraged the managed service of Azure, which is the IoT hub. And so, which gave us like an easily scalable option, but it is definitely something that we could tweak so that we don't, the frequency of our telemetry or our pings, they don't have to be every 5 seconds if you're not building a security device, for example. But for our use case, we just leverage Azure's managed service.
Right. I imagine you use an API gateway as well, right? Azure, so yes. That could also, you could implement rate limiting there if you needed to for any reason,
exactly.
Right?
Yes.
Another question is, what device did you use? Was it custom or available for anyone to buy?
I can take this. So we built a custom device with some proprietary protocols, but then this was then packaged and is available for the market to in the market for people to buy, but I cannot share details about which company, sorry.
Sure, understood. And the last question is also a short one, I hope. What time series database do you use?
Yeah,
I know, so you mentioned Cosmos DB at some point.
Yeah, in our use case, we evaluated a couple. One was Cassandra, and the other one was the Azure Time Series database itself. We sort of went ahead with Cassandra for most of our use cases, and because it allowed us to tweak most of our requirements as required, and performance was a key concern for us, right? And because we had Cassandra and in our control, it was easier for us to handle most of these use cases.
Great. Well, that's it for the questions. And fortunately, we got through them. We're just out of time now. So thank you for both of you for a wonderful presentation. And we'll switch on to our next session now. But thank you very much.
Bye. Cheers.